Hello everyone, welcome to IITians Gate classes. So today we are going to start our HAL series. So our first subject will be circuit theory on this. So this will be a simple quick revision session along with few questions that might be the pattern of the HAL or HPCL exam. So let us move forward then. So the first chapter in network theory or circuit theory as we know it is basics of circuit theory. So first let us know what is types of network. So any network, it can be any network element to be precise, can be linear or non-linear element. So what is a linear element? So a linear element has a linear relationship between voltage and current, and its graph always is a straight line passing through the origin. So if you check here, you can see what this voltage and this is my current, and this is a straight line that is passing through my origin. Okay, so if a element has a characteristics graph, VI characteristics graph like this, then it is linear. Is this linear? Means the element that has the characteristics graph like this, it is not linear. Why this is not linear? Because this graph, it is means you can see the characteristics, it is not passing through the origin. Okay, it is not passing through the origin. It is a straight line, but it is not passing through the origin. So that is why this is not a linear element. Now look at figure C. You can see this graph actually passes through the origin, but it is not a straight line. Okay, it is not a straight line. So even this is non-linear element. Okay, so if a element has its characteristics drawn like this, VI characteristics drawn like this, then this is a non-linear element. Now the next characteristics of any network element is bilateral and unilateral. So what do we mean by bilateral and what do we mean by unilateral? So bilateral element is an element that offers basically same impedance. Okay, it offers same impedance independent to the flow of direction of current. Okay, so suppose if I have a element like this, X. So if current is flowing in this direction, this element X has an impedance Z. Okay. Now suppose current is flowing in this direction. Okay. The same current is flowing in this direction. Still, if this element has impedance as Z, then this element X is known as what? Bilateral element. Okay. And for unilateral element, the element offers different impedance in different region of the characteristics. Okay. So in bilateral element, we have what? Our characteristics, it is independent of the direction of the flow of current. And in unilateral element, the impedance is actually dependent on the direction of the flow of the current. Okay. So now here you can see there are four figures, okay, four characteristics VI curve. So let us see which of them are bilateral, which of them are unilateral. So before moving on to this, let us see actually in which region my impedance is positive and in which region my impedance is negative. Okay. So in this first quadrant, you can see your V is positive, your I is positive. So your impedance, it will be positive. In the second quadrant, you can see V is positive, I is negative. So Z will be negative. In the third quadrant, you can see V is negative, I is also negative, so Z will be automatically, it will be positive. And in the fourth quadrant, you can see what? This is my first, second, third, and this is my fourth quadrant. So in fourth quadrant, you can see what? V is negative, I is positive, so Z will be my negative. Okay, this is very simple. Now come to this. Okay, now let us see in this figure 1, figure A, figure B, figure C and figure D. Okay, so if you see in the figure A, it is actually in my first quadrant and in third quadrant. So here your Z will be positive and even here your Z will be positive. Okay, so this is actually what? This is a bilateral element. Basically, if I have to see tell you a basic, very basic trick. So bilateral element its characteristics is symmetrical, is symmetrical about the origin. Okay, a bilateral element has means it is its characteristics is actually symmetrical about the origin. Now come to this figure B. Here you can see Z is negative and in this region also Z is negative. Okay, so and if you put, you see a mirror at this position, you are seeing what? It is actually symmetrical about this origin. So this is also bilateral element, this is also bilateral. Now check for this one. This you can see it is not symmetrical about origin. So this is unilateral element, and if you check, Z is positive here, Z is negative here. Okay, so this is a unilateral element. What about this one? Here you can see Z is positive, here also Z is positive. Okay, and if you put a mirror, or if you see, this characteristics graph is actually symmetrical about origin. So this is why this is also bilateral. Okay, now before moving into the next section, I want to tell you something. Note point. So this might be asked in a one mark question. All linear elements are bilateral but reverse is not true. What do I mean by that? All the linear elements are naturally bilateral, but all the bilateral elements are not linear. Okay, so let us go to the previous slide. Here you can see this is actually linear and this is bilateral also. In this graph you can see this is bilateral but this is non-linear. Okay, so even if I see in this graph, look at this graph, this is actually linear, this figure B is a linear element and it is also bilateral. So what I am trying to say is all linear elements are bilateral but all bilateral elements are not linear. Okay, so keep this thing a note. Now my third characteristics of network element is passive and active element. So what do we mean by passive and active elements? So active elements are those elements which deliver power or they offer negative impedance. What I said? Active elements are those elements which offer, which gives actually, which delivers power or it has a negative impedance. What about passive elements? Passive elements are those network element which absorb power or they offer positive impedance. Okay, positive impedance. So any example of active element you have in mind? So basically current source or voltage source, these are my what? These are my active elements. Passive elements, passive elements can be R, L, C. Okay, L and C, so remember this, L and C, while charging they act as passive element, while discharging they act as a source. So that is why they will be active element when they are discharging. Okay, so remember this also. And now if you want to check in this element, means in this characteristics, you can see here Z is positive and even Z is positive in this region. So this is my passive element. Here you can see Z is negative, here Z is negative, so this is my active element. Here you can see Z is positive, here you can see Z is negative, so this is again my active element. Here Z is positive, here Z is negative, So this is what? Sorry, here also z is positive. So this is my passive element. Here in this region you can see z is positive only, and here z is 0. So this is also my passive element. Here you can see z is negative and here z is positive. So this is also my active element. Okay, active element. Why active element? Because z is negative in this region and z is positive in this region. That means what? For certain value of I, for certain value of V, my this characteristics or this element, it acts as an active source. And for certain value of I, precisely for this value of I, it acts as a absorber or it absorbs power. Okay. So our next section is what? It is electrical network components. So the basic components like resistor, inductor, capacitor, we are going to see their basic characteristics and what are their nature. Okay. So what is resistor? Resistor, it is a component which opposes the flow of current. So resistor, it is a component which offers a resistive path or it opposes the flow of current. So this is actually the basic symbol of resistor. Okay, so V is equal to IR. So what is this law known as? This is basically Ohm's law. Okay, this is Ohm's law. So look very carefully. So if my current is flowing in this direction, this is my resistance. So this is my V is equal to IR. Okay. Now suppose current is flowing in this direction, then V is equal to minus IR. Why minus IR? Because we know current always flows from positive direction to negative direction. But here you can see current is flowing opposite to that rule. Okay, here current is flowing from minus direction to positive direction. So that is why we have a negative sign over here to indicate that the polarity of the voltage is actually opposite to the direction of flow of current. Okay. Now, if I plot the VI characteristics of a resistor, okay. So, if I plot a VI characteristics of a resistor, you will be seeing it is a linear element. Okay, it is a linear element. So this is my V, this is my I, and the slope of this characteristics is basically what? This is my resistor. So resistance is equal to the slope of VI characteristics graph. Okay, so this basically, this V is equal to IR is known as what? This is our famous Ohm's law. Okay. Now you can see I have written here only this V is equal to R into I. So this is in time domain. If I want to convert this in S domain or Laplace, so simple it is Vs is equal to R Is. Okay. Now Ohm's law, it is valid for constant temperature. So remember this, make a point of this, that Ohm's law, it is valid for constant temperature. And resistance, how does it varies with temperature? This is the formula for that. RT is equal to R naught 1 plus alpha T. So what is alpha here? It is the temperature coefficient of resistance in degree Celsius. Okay, thermal coefficient of resistance. R naught, it is the resistance of the material at 0 degree C, and T is temperature in Celsius. So this is basically the vary in resistance with the change in temperature. And if I want to calculate resistance of a piece of wire or a piece of material, the formula is given by R is equal to rho L by A. where rho is basically the resistivity of a material. So what is resistivity of a material? Resistivity of a material is the resistance offered by a material of having dimensions 1 meter cube or having volume 1 meter cube. So basically what? Resistivity of a material is actually the resistance of a block having dimensions 1 meter. So length 1 meter, breadth 1 meter and this height. Okay. So this is actually length, this is breadth and this is my height. So it is actually the resistance of a material having volume 1 meter cube and the resistance is measured this diagonally. Okay. So this is actually resistivity of the material. A is the cross section of the element and L is actually length of conductor in meter. So this is the formula for resistance of calculating a material. Okay. So now let us see few things. So current, we know current is defined as rate of change of charge with respect to time, or we know as I is equal to dq by dt. Okay, rate of change of charge per unit time. Okay, this is known as my current. And what about voltage? Voltage is basically the work done to take a unit charge, to take a unit charge from infinity to a point. Basically, okay. Voltage is known as the work done per unit charge, or as the definition I told you, it is actually the work done to take a unit positive charge from a infinity point to a particular point, that is known as my voltage. And power, power, it is basically what? It is the product of voltage into current is known as my power. So if I multiply this two equation, so what I get? Dq by dt into dw by dq. Dq. So this dq dq gets cancelled. So power is equal to dw by dt, or power, as I can say, is the rate of change of work or rate of change of energy with respect to time. Okay, power is also known as rate of change of energy per unit time. It is known as my power. Okay, so this is the definition of power. And in resistor, I can replace V by IR. So this is the formula for power in a resistor, or I can replace I by V by R. Okay, so this is the both the formula of power in case of resistor. Now let us talk about series configuration of resistance. Series configuration of resistance and parallel combination. So if I talk about series configuration and parallel configuration, you can see in series configuration, the equivalent resistance, it is basically the addition of R1 and R2, or I can say it is basically the addition of individual resistance in series is actually the equivalent resistance. And in parallel, it is this kind of thing. Okay. Means what? It is actually the reciprocal that we need to add. Okay. So R equivalent is basically what? We need to add the reciprocal of resistors. Okay. So this is my parallel combination, or simply what I can write? R equivalent is equal to R1 into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Okay. So as simple as that. So here actually R equivalent, it is equal to minimum, or I can say not even minimum, it is actually less than the R equivalent is greater than the maximum of R1 and R2. Okay, and in parallel, if I talk, so R equivalent is actually less than the minimum of R1 and R2. Okay, so if I have to explain that, what do I mean by that? Suppose I have two resistance in series. So one of them is 2, another is 4. So R equivalent will be what? R equivalent is 6. And you can see R equivalent is actually greater than maximum of 2 and 4. So this is what I was saying. 6 is greater than maximum of 2 and 4 is what? 4. So 6 is greater than 4. If I talk about parallel, so R equivalent, if the same resistors are connected in parallel, R equivalent will be what? 2 into 4 divided by 2 plus 4. So this will be 8 by 6 or 4 by 3. So that is approximately 1.33. So what I told, R equivalent is less than minimum of 2 and 4. You can see that 1.33 is actually minimum of 2 and 4. Okay, so minimum of 2 and 4 is what? 2. So this is what I was trying to explain here. Now let us talk very briefly about capacitor. So what is capacitor? Capacitor is an element which stores electrostatic energy, or it is a circuit element which actually opposes the change in voltage. Okay, so this is my capacitor. If I give you the formula for capacitance, so it is basically what? C is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r A by D, where epsilon naught is permittivity of free space, which has the unit farad per meter. Relative permittivity, epsilon r is basically relative permittivity of dielectric. So this is basically a ratio and it is unitless. Remember this. If they ask you what is the unit of relative permittivity of dielectric or relative dielectric constant, you will be saying it is unitless. A is what? It is area of the plates, and it has unit meter square. D is distance between the plates. Okay, distance between the plates, and its unit is meter. Here actually the charge stored by capacitor is equal to the capacitance into the voltage between the plates. Okay, so if I apply Ohm's law here, so this is also one kind of Ohm's law, where Q, if I draw a characteristics between Q and V, the slope that I get is basically what? It is my C. So the slope of this graph is C. Remember this. So this is what? Q is charge here, charge stored by this plate or capacitor. C is the capacitance, V is my voltage applied between the plates. And what is the energy that has been stored by the capacitor? So that is E is equal to half CV square. Okay, so we all know this. Okay, so very simple thing. Now, okay, one thing I want to tell you people, after charging a capacitor, listen this very carefully, after charging a capacitor, if I remove it from the circuit, okay, so it will store the electrostatic energy. It will store the electrostatic energy till discharging happens, okay. So remember this point. Now, if I talk about the equivalent or the Ohm's law. Ohm's law means what? Basically, it is the relationship between the current and voltage of an element. So if I talk about that, so in time domain for this capacitor, IC is equal to C dVc by dt, or voltage across the capacitor is what? 1 by C integration of IC dt. Okay. So if I draw a graph, so this is the Ohm's law, actual Ohm's law. This was a type of Ohm's law. Okay. Now if I talk about actual Ohm's law, so if I draw a graph between IC and differentiation of voltage across the capacitor with respect to time, the slope that I get is actually C. Okay. So this is known as what? This is my actual Ohm's law. I is equal to C dVc by dt. And if I take the S domain or Laplace transform of the above equation, you can see what? ICS is equal to CS into VCS and VC is equal to 1 by CS IS. What is this actually? This 1 by CS? Look, VCS by ICS, it is what? It is my impedance ZS. So, the impedance of capacitor is what? 1 by CS. Okay, 1 by CS. Previously, in case of resistor, what we saw? VS is equal to VS by IS is actually R. So, the impedance of resistor is equal to the resistance only. Impedance of capacitor is not equal to the capacitance. It is equal to 1 by CS. Okay. So, remember this point also. So, this is what I have written. Impedance. And opposite of impedance is what? Admittance. So, admittance of capacitor is what? CS. Now, if I talk about equivalent circuit for series, you can see the equivalent is calculated like this. And if I talk previously, like I had talked for resistor, so C equivalent, it will be less than minimum of C1 and C2 in case of series capacitor. Okay. In case of parallel capacitor, you can see it is actually following the style of my series. Sorry, it is actually following the style of my series resistor. Okay. So C equivalent here is actually greater than maximum of C1 and C2. Okay. So, remember this, both the formulas. Now, let us talk about inductor. What is an inductor? So, inductor is an element which stores energy in the form of magnetostatic energy, or it is an element which opposes the change in current. So, it is an element which opposes the change in current. Previously, capacitor, it was an element which opposes the change in voltage, and resistance, it is actually the property of an element which opposes the flow in current. Okay. So, remember all this point properly, because in HAL or HPCL exam, they might ask you questions from this theory. So, don't get confused. Okay. And one thing I told you in capacitor, that if I charge the capacitor and then if I remove it from the circuit, so what happens? It will store the energy. It will store the electrostatic energy. But in case of inductor, suppose if I charge an inductor and if then I remove it from the circuit, it will not hold the energy. It will immediately discharge. Okay. It will immediately discharge in the form of magnetostatic dissipation. Okay. So, remember this, inductor, it cannot hold the energy, while capacitor, it can hold the electrostatic energy. Inductor cannot hold my magnetostatic energy. Okay. Now, if I talk about the formula for inductor, what it is? L is equal to mu naught N square A by L. So, what is mu naught? It is permittivity is used in capacitor. In case of inductor, it is permeability. So, permeability of free space is what? Mu naught, and its unit is Henry per meter. N is equal to number of turns in the inductor coil. A is the area of coil, like this. Okay. So, this will keep on turning. So, this is my area of the coil. And what is L? L is actually the length of this coil. Okay. So, this is what? This is the basic formula for deriving the inductance of a coil. What? Inductance of a coil. Now, if I talk about what is the total magnetic flux. So, this psi is basically what? Total magnetic flux. So, this is also actually one kind of Ohm's law, where the characteristics is between total magnetic flux psi and I. So, if I draw this, So it will be a straight line. Please mind my drawing. So that is not actually looking straight, but this is straight line. So the slope actually gives me L. So if I draw a characteristics graph between total magnetic flux versus the current, I will be getting the slope as my inductance. Okay. And the energy that is stored by this coil or inductor is what? Half Li square. Previously in case of capacitor, it was half CV square. Here it is half Li square. Previously in capacitor, you would have seen Q is equal to CV. Okay, charge stored or total charge is actually is equal to the capacitance into the voltage. Here it is what? Total magnetic flux. Total magnetic flux is what? L into I. Now come here. Now see this diagram. See this diagram here. So if you see here, this is actually the Ohm's law that I have written. So what it is, VL is equal to L di by dt, or we know what IL is equal to 1 by L 0 to t VL dt, d tau. So this tau is basically a free variable or a running variable, I can say. Okay. So if I convert this into S domain or Laplace domain, you see what, VL is equal to LS ILS or IL is equal to 1 by LS VLS. Okay. So here you can see what is the impedance, VL by IL is equal to LS. So impedance of inductor is basically what, it is LS, and admittance of inductor is what, it is 1 by LS. Now talking about equivalent circuit, okay, series equivalent circuit and parallel equivalent circuit of inductor, it follows the same style as resistor. Capacitor, it was following the inverse style of resistor. Inductor, it follows the same style of resistor. So if I talk about that, L equivalent will be what? In case of series, it will be greater than maximum of L1, L2. And L equivalent in case of parallel will be less than minimum of L1, L2. Okay. So remember this thing. Now you people might be wondering, why didn't I tell you about the equivalent circuit when we have mutual coupling in between coil? So I will discuss that also later on in the same section in the circuit theory lecture only. I will be discussing that when I talk about magnetic circuits. Okay. So in that magnetic coupling circuit, we know we will be seeing all those things. So don't worry, I will be covering everything in this section. Okay. So that will be required for your HAL and HPCL exam. So don't worry. Okay. So our next topic is very important. It is actually what? Voltage divider rule. So what is voltage divider rule? It is applicable for series circuit only. In series circuit, we can divide the voltage according to the voltage divider rule. Suppose we have two elements that has impedance Z1 and Z2, and along the terminals the total voltage is V. So what is V1? That is the voltage of this Z1 element, means the element that has impedance Z1. And what is the voltage V2? That is actually the voltage of the element that has impedance Z2. So it is given by this formula. Okay, V is equal to Z1 divided by Z1 plus Z2, and V2 is equal to I into Z2, which is equal to V into Z2 divided by Z1 plus Z2. So this is actually very important. Now suppose we have a circuit like this. So here suppose this is my VI and this is my V naught. This is R, this is C. So how do we calculate V naught? Simply by using voltage divider rule. Why we are applying voltage divider rule? Because you can see this is I. This I is flowing here. Here it is open circuit. So zero current will be flowing. So this I will be flowing through this capacitor also. Okay. So this is a series circuit. So here we will be taking the impedance of the capacitor. What is the impedance of resistor? It will be R only. So V naught is equal to 1 by Cs divided by R plus 1 by Cs into the total voltage that has been applied. So the total voltage is Vi. So if I take LCM, it will be what? 1 divided by RCS plus 1 into Vi. Okay, and this is also a low pass filter. So let us not discuss about that. While we discuss filtering circuit or filter circuits, at that time we will see all these things. Okay, so now here actually I have discussed the voltage divider theorem, VDR, okay, voltage divider rule, for R, L and C. Okay, R, L, C I have discussed. So you can see here my impedance Z is equal to R, and V1, which is actually the voltage across this resistance R1, is given by V into R1 divided by R1 plus R2. V2 is what? V into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So this is quite normal. Even in case of inductor, inductor follows the same style as my resistor. Okay, inductor follows the same style as my resistor, but look in case of capacitor. Capacitor is little bit tricky, and always remember here V1 is equal to V into the opposite capacitance that has been asked. Suppose V1, V1 is the voltage across this capacitor C1. So while calculating V1, we will take in numerator C2. You can see C2 divided by C1 plus C2, and while calculating V2, we will not consider C2 in the numerator but C1. Okay, so for calc means the voltage divider of this capacitor is very, very important and tricky. So always keep this thing in mind while solving questions. We will see few tricky questions that might be asked to you people. Okay, so the next important thing is star to delta and delta to star conversion. So first we will be seeing what is star to delta conversion, or also known as T to pi conversion. So this is my star network. Okay, this is my star network and this is my T network. Okay, this is my delta network and this is my pi network. So how do we convert a star to delta, or equivalently T network to pi network? See, there are two ways in which I solve this. Okay, so first way is I keep this order of naming same. So look here, if this is Z1, Z2 and Z3, I will always keep the branches of my delta as this branch as my Z1, this branch as my Z2 and this branch as my Z13. Now if I want to calculate Z12, look here very carefully, I will be multiplying one on one each term. Okay, so Z1 into Z2 plus Z2 into Z3 plus Z1 into Z3. So this is common in all the three branches of delta. Now suppose I want to calculate Z12. So what is missing in Z12? 3 is missing, so I will be dividing by 3. In Z13, what is missing? Z2 is missing, so divided by Z2. In Z23, what is missing? Z1 is missing, so I will be dividing by Z1. Similarly, in T network also you can do the same. Okay, you can do the same, but remember this thing, if you are using this trick, okay, so you have to always remember that the adjacent branch of Z13, look, Z13, it will be what? It is Z13. Adjacent means the adjacent branch in the delta for Z2 and Z3 is what? Z23. And for Z12, the branch in delta will be Z12. So you have to always remember this diagram for applying this trick. But I have one more trick with me. Okay, so that is very, very simple while converting from T to pi. Okay, so what is that trick? So suppose I have to calculate this Z1, Z12, Z13, Z23. I have been given with this thing. So I will demonstrate this method with the help of an example. Okay, I will be using one example to solve this. So here I won't be requiring anything to remember. So this is 1, this is 2, this is 3. Now I need to get what? This resistance R1, R2, R3. Very simple. Just you have to remember this point while you are converting from T to delta network. There is a one-on-one multiplication with each term. Just remember this thing. What I told, when you are converting from T to delta, there is a one-on-one multiplication, multiplication with each term. That is very simple actually. Okay, so now if I want to calculate R1, so look how I will be calculating. R1 will be what? 1 into 2 plus 1 into 3 plus 2 into 3 divided by, so R1, opposite to R1 in the corresponding delta is what? This 3 ohm. Okay, these are all in ohms. Okay, I forgot to write. So corresponding to R1, what is the opposite in the T network? It is this 3. So you will be dividing by 3. For R2, you will be copying this whole again. This multiplication of one-on-one multiplication will be common. So you will be multiplying this divided by, look, the corresponding T network which is opposite to R2. Look what it is. It is this 2 ohm. So 2. Similarly, you can find R3. Now, if I go back to the previous diagram also, you can see opposite to Z12. What it is? It is Z3. You can see Z3 is here. Opposite to Z13. What is opposite? It is Z2. You can see Z2 is here. Okay. Opposite to Z23 in the corresponding star network, what it is? It is Z1. You can see Z1 is present over here. So no need to memorize any formula. No need to memorize any formula in star to delta conversion. If you follow this simple trick, that is what? In star to delta conversion, there is one-on-one multiplication of each of the impedance or resistance. Okay, each of the impedance, these are my impedance, or previous, in the next previous example, I have considered resistance here. Okay. So remember this. Now, one thing I want to share with you people is, let me copy this diagram. See, for resistance and for inductance, it will be very, very simple. But what about capacitance? Suppose here instead of Z1, I had C1. C1, C2, C3. And instead of Z12, Z13, Z23, I have C12. This is C13, this is C23. So I will be solving just for this C1, okay? Just for this C1, I will be solving. If you look, previously I was using this Z formula, okay? Impedance formula. So what was Z12? Z12 was Z1 into Z2 plus Z2 into Z3 plus Z1 into Z3 divided by Z3. Okay, so this was the formula. Now here what happened? Z12 is replaced by C12. So what is the impedance of C12? it will be 1 by C 1 to S, which is equal to, what is impedance of Z1? It will be 1 by C 1 S into 1 by C 2 S plus 1 by C 2 S into 1 by C 3 S plus 1 by C 1 S 1 by C 3 S divided by 1 by C 3 S. So, one of the S I can cancel out. Okay, one of the S in each term I can cancel out. Now, what is remaining? Look very, very careful. In terms of capacitance, it is quite difficult, and you will be using this method only to calculate the equivalent delta network. Okay. So, I am left with C12S is equal to, I have what? 1S is common here in the numerator. So, this S and this S, I can cancel with this S. Okay. So, it will be easier for us now. C12 is equal to C1 into C2 plus C2, sorry, 1 by C2 into C3 plus 1 by C1 into C3 divided by 1 by C3. Now, multiply numerator and denominator by C1, C2, C3. So, this will be 1 by C12 is equal to C3 plus C1 plus C2 divided by C1 into C2. So, what is C12 now? C12 is C1 into C2 divided by C3 plus C2 plus C1. So, remember this. It is very, very important that you take very good care while solving the capacitance. Okay, while solving the capacitance, you have to remember this thing. So, if you need to find C12, okay, C12, if you need to find C12, so what will you do? In the corresponding T branch or in the star branch, look in this vertex and in this vertex, which of the capacitance are connected. You can see C1 is connected and C2 is connected. You will be multiplying those and you will be dividing it with all the capacitance, addition of all the capacitance. But it is quite confusing to remember all these things. Okay, so I will suggest you to remember this way only. Okay, this way, opposite of impedance. In examination hall, it will take you very, very less time to solve. I was explaining, so it took me, I had to write all these things. But while you are in practice, you will be getting this result well within 2 minutes. Okay, so don't worry, don't memorize anything. It is better actually to understand rather than memorizing thing. Okay, because who knows, in examination hall, due to some pressure, you might be forgetting whatever you have retained. Okay, so please understand things rather than memorizing things. Okay, now how to convert delta to star or pi to T. Okay, so for here also I have a basic, very simple formula here also. Now if I have to use this naming formula, okay, if I have to use the name formula like previously I had used here, okay, Z12, so Z3, so again you have to memorize this diagram, okay, for using that trick. So here you can see for calculating Z1, you are seeing what Z1, actually you have to write all the corresponding pi network or delta network where there is 1. So, Z12, Z13, you are seeing Z12 and Z13 due to this 1, okay, divided by Z1 plus Z12, sorry, Z13 plus Z23. Similarly, for Z2, it will be Z12 and Z23, as 2 is common in both Z12 and Z23. Okay, so this is actually, you have to memorize this diagram, okay. But I have a very simple trick for this one also. Look, suppose this is given. Now for calculating Z1, Z1, what will you do? Z1, look at the corresponding delta network. Z1, it is in between Z12 and Z13. okay, like this. So here is my Z1, this is my Z2, this is my Z3. So Z1 is in between Z12 and Z13. So simply write Z12 into Z13 divided by Z12 plus Z23 plus Z13. Similarly, if you have to write Z3, so for Z3, it is in between Z13 and Z23. So simply Z13 into Z23 divided by Z12 plus Z13 plus Z23. Okay, so this is very simple. Again, you will be seeing there is means for resistance and inductance, it will not be a problem. We will be following this structure and it will be same. But for capacitance, if I have to see, simply if you replace this Z12 by C12, I will be showing you one, then you can derive for the rest of the C2 and C3. So let me assume this is C12, this is C13 and this is C23. Okay, so this will be C1, C2 and C3. Okay, now look at this formula, Z1 divided by Z12, Z13. So if I go with this formula, what is the impedance for C1? It will be C1s is equal to Z12 is what? I am calculating for this one, okay, C1. So Z12 is what? It is actually in between this one and this one. So C12 is 1 by C12s into 1 by C13s divided by 1 by C12s plus 1 by C13s plus 1 by C23s. So one of the s will be cancelled with this s, okay, and one of this s will be cancelled here. Now what I need to do, 1 by C1 is equal to, if I multiply numerator and denominator by C12, C13, C23, what will I get? Here I will be getting C23 divided by C13 into C23 plus C23 into C12 plus C12 into C13. So you need to just reverse this. So C1 will be C13 into C23 plus C23 into C12 plus C12 into C13 divided by C23. Okay, so this formula is quite similar to start to delta conversion. Start to delta conversion, we had 1 to 1 multiplication, and here also you can see when we are converting a delta to star in capacitance, at that time we are having this 1 to 1 multiplication. Okay, so in whenever we are solving with capacitor, you have to be extra cautious due to this thing only, because the impedance of capacitor is actually the inverse of C due to this. Okay, so please pay very good attention while solving for capacitance. Now the next important thing in basics of circuit theory is sources. So we have two types of sources here, voltage source and current source. So first let us look into the ideal voltage source. What is ideal voltage source? So ideal voltage source, in ideal voltage source, voltage of the source is always constant irrespective of the current flowing through it. Okay, so what I am trying to say, whatever is the current that is being drawn through this load terminal, okay, whatever is the current that is being drawn through this load terminal, voltage across this load terminal will always remain the same. Okay, you can see voltage, this Vt is actually what? This is the voltage across this load terminal, and voltage across load terminal is constant irrespective of the current that has been drawn by this load. Okay, this load can be resistive, purely resistive, or it can be mixture of resistance and capacitance, or resistance and inductance. It depends. Okay, it depends totally. But in case of ideal voltage source, whatever may be the current that has been drawn from the load, my voltage across the load, it will be maintained at a constant value in case of ideal voltage source. And this is the VI characteristics of an ideal voltage source. You are seeing what? That my voltage is constant irrespective of the current change. So the next topic is practical voltage source. What do we mean by practical voltage source? In practical voltage source, we have a simple small series resistance with the source voltage source. Okay, previously you can see there was no resistance in series with this voltage source. But now in case of practical voltage source, I have a small series resistance. This RS value is very, very less or approximately equal to zero, but not, it is not zero. Okay. So you can see this is my series resistance that has been connected to this voltage source. Now here you can check whatever with the increase in my current, what will happen? The voltage, it will start dropping around the load terminal. Okay, you can see in this graph, previously this red graph indicates my ideal voltage source. And this green color characteristics, it denotes my practical voltage source. Now, why does this voltage drop is taking place when we increase current? So when we increase current, what happens? This here, there is a voltage drop, okay, Vs. Let me denote it by Vs. With the amount of increase in current, my Vs will also increase. So if I have to write the KVL equation, what it will be? V is equal to Vs plus Vt. I can write it like this, It into RS plus Vt, okay, not Vt, it is V of T, okay, V of T. Now what happens if I increase It, if I increase current, what will happen? Vt is equal to minus It RS plus V. If I increase the current, what will happen? There will be a huge amount of voltage drop in this resistance, RS, source resistance. So that is why you can see with very much increase in current, what will happen? Most of the voltage drop, it will take place here, and the voltage across the terminal of load, it will be what? It is approximately equal to zero at this position, where my current is what? Current is V by RS. When V by RS is happening, at that point my voltage to the terminal, it will be zero. Okay. So this is what I have written. With the increase in current, the voltage across load decreases. So keep this thing in mind, the characteristics of ideal voltage source and the characteristics of practical voltage source. Okay. Now the next topic is my ideal current source. So what is ideal current source? Ideal current source is a source which supplies constant current irrespective to the change in voltage of the load terminal. So whatever may be the voltage across the load terminal, it doesn't matter. A current source will always supply constant current to the load. So this is the basic VI characteristics of a ideal current source. You can see here what? That my current is constant, current is I, irrespective of the voltage change. So this is V of T, irrespective of the voltage change or the voltage of the load terminal. So this is what I have written, the current always remains constant for any value of voltage across it. Okay, so this voltage is also the voltage across this current source. Okay, So whatever is the voltage across this current source will always maintain a constant flow of current in the branch it is connected. Okay. Now what is practical current source? Practical current source, in a practical current source, we have a high value of resistance if this is RS. So I think I should have denoted it by IS, and here also it will be IS then. So this is also IS. So here what happens, this RS is approximately equal to infinite. So if it is approximately equal to infinite or very high value, what happens, the current flowing through it will be negligible. There will be a very negligible amount of current that is flowing through this RS. Most of the current it will flow through this load. But what happens if we increase the VT? If VT increases, that means what? My RS, VT is what? This V of T is equal to, let me assume the current flowing through here is I1. So I1 into RS. So if my voltage is increasing, that means what? My current is increasing. So when will my current increase? When my RS is less, okay? When my RS is a small value, at that time what will happen? More amount of current will flow through this region, through this resistance. So that is why the basic condition that we have here is R load should be greater than, sorry, yeah, R, I was writing the opposite thing, RS must be very, very greater than R load. So what will happen? Negligible amount of current will flow through this RS, and most of the current it will flow through this load. Okay, so here I have written the KVL equation for this thing. You can see VT is equal to minus ITR plus IR. So this I is basically IS. Okay, IS. So IS is the current through this current source, and this is VT. As it is connected in parallel, so this voltage across the load will be equal to the voltage across this one, this resistance, and voltage across the current source. So here also you can see, if I increase the voltage, the current through the load decreases. I have already explained why the current through the load will decrease, because if voltage increases, what happens? This resistance value means current is increasing through this value. When will my current increase? When my RS is less. So at that time, if RS is if RS is less than R load, what will happen? Maximum amount of current will flow through this branch, because we know current flows through the least resistance path. So RS, through RS, maximum current will flow instead of current flowing through this load. So this case should be avoided. Okay, avoided. So remember this point also. So the next topic is what? Dependent sources. So what is dependent sources? It is a kind of amplifying action that is happening here. So dependent sources, there are four kind of dependent sources. One of them is current controlled voltage source. Second one is what? Voltage controlled voltage source. Okay, so these are kind of amplifiers, I can say. Next is what? Current controlled current source. So current controlled current source is what? Current controlled current source. And the last one is what? It is voltage controlled current source. Okay, so these are my four kinds of dependent sources that we have. So before moving on to the next topic, let me discuss with you the input impedance and output impedance of all the dependent sources. So if I have to discuss that, so let me make a table. So the first one is what? Voltage controlled voltage source. Second is what? Current controlled current source. Third is voltage controlled current source. And fourth is what? Current controlled voltage source. So for this first one, so can anyone tell me what will be this? Look very carefully. If you don't have to memorize anything, so this is what? Voltage controlled voltage source. Always remember, when it is voltage controlled voltage source, output is your voltage source. So this will act as my voltage source. For a voltage source, your input impedance is infinite, output impedance is zero. Okay, this is a voltage amplifier. This is a voltage amplifier. In voltage amplifier, we know what? Input impedance should be infinite and output impedance should be zero. Next is what? Current controlled current source. So this is a what? Current amplifier. Okay, current amplifier. And we have what is a current source. In current source, CCCS, current source, we know what? Input impedance should be zero. Output impedance should be what? Infinite. Because why? Input impedance should be zero. Input impedance, why it should be zero? Because if input impedance is not zero, then current will not flow. Current will not flow. And output impedance has to be infinite. Why? Because we are forcing maximum amount of current to flow through my load part. Okay, so that is why output impedance should be infinite. Next is what? Voltage controlled current source. So this is my current source. Voltage controlled, it is controlled by a voltage. Okay, voltage source or a voltage point. So for that, my input impedance should be infinite and my output impedance should be infinite. And for a current controlled voltage source, here my driving point is current. So for that, my input impedance should be zero. My output impedance, as it is a voltage source, so my output impedance should be zero. So this is the way you should be remembering this table. Okay, and they might ask you a question from this point. I hope this part is clear with you people. Okay, so please keep a note of this thing. And the way I told you, please don't memorize things. Okay, don't memorize thing. It is better to understand the concept behind it. These are all kind of amplifier. Okay, kind of amplifier. This is trans amplifier. Okay, why? Because we are amplifying a voltage in terms of current. Here we are amplifying voltage. Here we are amplifying current in terms of voltage. So these are all trans amplifier and these are normal voltage amplifier and current amplifier. Very simple thing. Never ever memorize thing. It is better to understand rather than memorizing. Okay. So the next topic are very very important and we have been using this from our basic electrical circuits. Okay. So what is that? The basic thing is Kirchhoff's law. So in that Kirchhoff's law, the first is what? Kirchhoff current law. So what does Kirchhoff current law states? The total current across any node in a given network is zero, or incoming current in a node is always equal to the outgoing current in a node. Okay, so what do I mean? That in a node, in an electric circuit, there is no current, or I can say there is no charge stored. Okay, in this point, this is a node. In this node, there is no current of its own or there is no charge store. Incoming current is always equal to the outgoing current. So there are two conventions actually for Kirchhoff current's law. So the first convention is what? Incoming current is considered as negative and outgoing current is considered as positive. So I follow this convention. Okay, wherever I will be solving questions with you people, I will be following this convention only. The second convention that is also used is incoming current is considered as positive and outgoing current is considered as negative. But as I told you, I will be following this convention only. So if I go with this convention, if I write the KCL at this point A, okay, so what it will be? Minus I2. So here I have written, so this I think I have made a mistake here, sorry. So this will be I1. So as I1 is incoming current, incoming to the node, so minus I1. I2 is outgoing, so plus I2. I3 is again incoming, minus I3. I4 is also incoming, so minus I4. I5 is outgoing current, so plus I5. I6 is again incoming, so minus I6 is equal to 0. So this is what Kirchhoff current law states. Now Kirchhoff current law is basically based on the conservation of charge. Okay, conservation of charge, what do we mean by that? That in a node there is no charge store. Whatever charge is coming, that charge is going also. As we are not storing any charge in the node, so that is why the incoming charge is equal to the outgoing charge. So this is what is the basis that forms the Kirchhoff current law. Now next is what we have, something known as nodal analysis. So what is nodal analysis? We are going to see in a question. So nodal analysis is basically the combination of Kirchhoff current law and Ohm's law. Okay, it is the combination of KCL and Ohm's law. So KCL, as we know, it is valid for linear, non-linear, unilateral, bilateral, active and passive element. Remember this, KCL is valid for linear, non-linear, even for unilateral, bilateral, active and passive element, as it is based for the conservation of charge. It is based on conservation of charge. Okay, so remember this. But Ohm's law, we have seen, it is valid only for linear, bilateral and passive network. It is not valid for non-linear network or non-linear element, not valid for unilateral elements or for active elements. So Ohm's law is only valid for linear, bilateral and passive elements. So as nodal analysis is basically combination of KCL and Ohm's law, so nodal analysis is valid for constant temperature. Why constant temperature? Because Ohm's law is also valid for constant temperature. So nodal analysis is also valid for constant temperature. It is valid for linear, bilateral and passive elements and lumped electrical network. What do we mean by lumped electrical network? See, a cable, it has what? It has distributed resistance, inductance and even some small value of capacitance. But we lump the whole of the resistance into one part. Okay, this is one whole resistance that we have lumped of this whole wire, and rest all of the wire from this point to this point, means whole of this point and this point, we consider the resistance to be zero. So this is what is meant by lumped electrical network, that we lump the resistance, inductance or capacitance of a distributed element in just one point. Okay, so this is known as my lumped electrical network. Now the next in our Kirchhoff law is Kirchhoff voltage law, also known as KVL. So KVL, what does it mean? According to KVL, the summation of voltage across any closed loop will be zero. Okay, so the summation of voltage across any closed loop will be zero. Now look very carefully, what is the convention, sign convention? You can see the current is flowing in this path. Okay, in this direction current is flowing, I. So if current is flowing in this, we know current flows from positive to negative in passive elements. Okay, so let me denote this by VR, this by VL and this by VC. So if I start from this point, KVL, it starts from one point and it ends at the same point. So if I start from this point, what do I see? I encounter a minus at this point. So I will be writing minus V. then I move on to here. I see here what? I have a plus. So I will be writing plus VR. Now again I move to this point, I see plus VL. Again I see what? Plus VC. This will be equal to 0. Why 0? Because after VC, what I see? I again return back to my same point. So this is the KVL. Suppose I don't want to go like this. I want to move in this direction. Okay. In this direction, if I want to move. So let me start from this point in this direction. So it will be what? Minus VC. Here you see you are encountering minus. So minus VL. Here you see what? You encounter minus. So it will be minus VR. And when you come at this point, you see you are encountering plus. So plus V equal to 0. You are seeing both the results are same. It doesn't matter if you start with the flow of current or opposite to the flow of current. If you follow the perfect sign convention, you will get the same result. So don't worry. Okay. So KVL, it is basically based on the conservation of energy. KCL was based on conservation of charge. KVL is based on the conservation of energy. Okay, so remember this point also. And we have something known as mesh analysis. So mesh analysis is basically the combination of KVL and Ohm's law. Okay, KVL and Ohm's law. Now for mesh analysis, the analysis will be same, just like nodal analysis. Mesh analysis is also valid for constant temperature. It is valid for linear, bilateral and passive element. It is valid for lump and electrical network. Okay. So it is same. This mesh analysis has the constraints same as the our nodal analysis. Okay. Now let us discuss few important equivalent circuit. So the first circuit you see is what? This is actually not open circuit. Okay. This A and B, this is not open circuit. This is terminal. Okay, we have some network over here which I have not drawn. So there is some network, so don't consider it as open circuit. Okay, we have some network at this point. So how do I condense all the three sources? So if I start from here, look from here. Okay, let me assume this is minus plus, this is VAB. So if I start from here, don't consider the resistance, we will consider the resistance later on. So if I see what is the equivalent voltage VAB, it is V1. Okay, VAB is what? V1. V1. Next you see what? It is minus V2. Next what you see? Plus V3. So VAB or V, I shouldn't be writing it as VAB because VAB, this is wrong, quite wrong. So don't write like this. So now look at this point. At this point, what is the voltage that I can write? If I summate this, all this voltage, what it will be? It will be V1. Look from here. Okay. You are encountering plus sign. So plus V1. Here you come. So minus V2. And when you come here, it is plus V3. So plus V3. So this V equivalent will be what? V1 minus V2 plus V3. And what will be R equivalent? You can see this R1 and R2, they are in series. Why they are in series? Because if a current I is flowing here, so the same current is flowing through R1 and same current is flowing through R2. So R equivalent will be R1 plus R2. Okay. So if you have a equivalent circuit, means if you are given a circuit like this, you can condense it to a simple circuit like this. So now suppose if we have a second circuit like this, where we have I1, I2 and I3. So look very carefully. You have to see the direction of current now. So I1 is in upward direction, I2 is in downward direction, I3 is in upward direction. Okay. So now if I have to write the equivalent current, it will be what? As I am considering upward current as positive and downward current as negative. It is my choice. You can consider the reverse thing also, it doesn't matter. Okay. So if I write I equivalent, I am considering upward as positive. So I1 minus I2 plus I3. So I equivalent will be this one. What will be R equivalent? R equivalent will be R1 into R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Why? Because R1 and R2, they are connected in parallel. And I have already told you, R equivalent is what? 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Okay? So, this is the equivalent circuit. Now, suppose if I have a resistance at this point. So, then my equivalent circuit, it will not be like this. Okay? Then I can condense this part. Look very carefully. If I have a resistance here, so what I will do? I can condense this two source, this two current source, and I will be leaving this current source alone. Okay? So remember this. I can condense this current source, this two current source. Again, I can add I3 minus I2 along with R2, and I will be having R1. But then this R1 and this R2 are not, means are they are not in parallel. Why? Because I have a resistance here. They are not even in series, they are not even in parallel. So take proper care, okay? So now if I have a voltage source like this with parallel to a R, what I can do? I can just exclude this resistance, okay? I can exclude this resistance in the equivalent circuit. Why can I exclude the R? Because voltage across this R is what? It is V. So I can exclude it. But remember one thing. Note, while power calculation never remove R. So if I have an ideal current source in parallel with a resistance, you can remove this resistance. But if you are calculating power for each and every element, including this resistance, never do it. Why? Because there will be a current that is coming through it. So never exclude it. And it's also better that we never exclude it. It is a dummy resistance. It's fine. You can keep it like that way. But if they ask you what is the equivalent circuit for this one, you can say this is the equivalent circuit. Okay. Now suppose if I have a ideal current source in series with the resistance. Okay. So I can replace this R by a short circuit. Previously I was replacing this R by a open circuit. Now I can replace this R by a short circuit. So again the same thing follows. If you have power calculation, please never remove R or never short circuit R in this case. Okay. So again here my R is a dummy resistance. It is better to not remove this resistance. Okay. But if they ask you equivalent circuit for this circuit, you will be saying this is the equivalent circuit. Okay. But while calculation, it is my advice to you people, my personal advice, don't remove this R, because this R, it will just have a simple voltage drop, and that will be what? As current is flowing in this direction, it will be plus to minus V. Okay. So never remove this, where V is equal to your IR. So don't do this. Okay. Don't do this means don't remove. But if they ask you equivalent circuit, at that time you need to remove. Okay. Now this is very important and confusing. When I have a voltage source and a current source in parallel, which of them has more priority? Always remember, voltage source has more priority when a voltage source and a current source are connected in parallel. So this circuit, I can redraw it like this. Okay, remember this. Whenever an ideal voltage source and an ideal current source are connected in parallel, at that time voltage source has my high priority compared to my current source. Always remember this. And when I have an ideal current source connected with an ideal voltage source in series, at that time my current source has high priority. Okay, remember this. And the equivalent circuit will be what? It will be like this. Okay, so remember this. they might ask you such type of simple questions. Okay, so remember all this thing. Now the next topic that we have is source transformation. Okay, so what is source transformation? So source transformation is basically conversion of practical voltage source to practical current source. Okay, if I want to convert a practical voltage source to a practical current source, I will take help of source transformation. Remember this note point, source transformation is invalid for ideal sources. Okay, remember this point, source transformation is invalid for ideal sources. It is valid, this source transformation or concept of source transformation, it is valid only for practical sources. So how do we convert a practical voltage source to a practical current source? It is very simple. Here we have what? Voltage source in series with a source resistance, in series with a load resistance. So we will be applying source transformation along this terminal AB. So if I want to convert this voltage source to a practical current source, the value of current will be Vs by Rs along with a parallel resistance to the practical current source having the value Rs. Okay, having the value Rs. So this will be the source transformation when I want to convert a voltage source to a current source, a practical voltage source to a practical current source. Okay, remember. So what will be the value of the current source? It will be voltage source divided by the source resistance, and there will be also a parallel resistance to the current source. That is what? The resistance of that parallel resistance is given by Rs. Okay. Now what if I want to convert a current source to a voltage source? So here the value of this voltage source will be what? Is into Rs. It will be in series with a source resistance having my resistance as Rs. Okay, very simple thing, very simple. Okay, there is no means concept in this thing. Okay, and if you want to prove, do one thing. You just means you apply here at this point, you apply KCL. Okay, consider this as VA, consider this point as VA. You calculate VA here and you calculate VA here. What will be VA here? Let me prove you. So VA will be equal to what? Is Rs into RL divided by Rs plus RL. So how did I get VA? Basically it is voltage divider. Now what will be VA here? So simply what I will do for calculating VA, let me calculate IA over here. So IA I can calculate like by current divider rule. So it will be Is into Rs divided by Rs plus RL. Fine. Now what will be VA? VA is IA into RL. So simply multiply this, you will be seeing what? Is into Rs into RL divided by Rs plus RL. So as I am getting the voltage same, that means my source transformation is correct. You can see both the values of voltage VA is same, Is Rs RL divided by Rs plus RL, both is same. Okay, so very simple concept. Now what is the note point I have written? In case of source transformation, direction of current will be from negative polarity to positive polarity. Remember this. See, I forgot actually to tell. You can see when I converted this current source to voltage source, the direction of polarity, it will be opposite to the conventional current flow. Conventional current flow is fraught. It is from positive side to negative side. But here you can see it is flowing from negative to positive. It is flowing from negative to positive. So this actually, what do we have? Here you can see what? That my voltage source has polarity from minus to plus, opposite to the direction of flow of conventional current. You can see conventional current, it flows from positive to negative, but it is flowing opposite, minus to plus. Always remember. Okay, So always remember, when you convert a current source to an equivalent voltage source, so the arrow position where there is the head of the arrow, you will mark it as plus, and the tail of the arrow, you will mark it as negative. Similarly, here also you can see this is plus and this is minus. So when you convert a voltage source to a practical voltage source, to a practical current source, wherever there is plus sign, there will be head of the arrow, and wherever there is minus sign, that will be the tail of the arrow. You can see, okay, you can see this also here. Okay, what is the next note point? Source transformation is valid for dependent as well as independent sources. Okay, it is valid for dependent as well as independent sources, not applicable for ideal voltage source and not ideal current source. So it is not valid for ideal voltage source as well as ideal current source. So all these points keep in mind. Okay, now the next is what we have, concept of equipotential. So what is concept of equipotential? It is also known as the concept of my symmetry. Okay, concept of symmetry, and it is valid only for symmetrical figure. Okay, this concept of equipotential is valid for symmetrical figure only. Suppose I have a cube which has six faces, okay, six faces, and each of the vertices or each of the arms of this cube has an impedance Z. Okay, Z, 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 Z. How many such arms are here? Tell me. How many such arms are here? So in total there will be 12 arms. So 12 such impedance will be there. Okay, one thing I want to tell, I haven't placed a box over here for indicating the impedances. I have denoted it with the resistance. Okay, so you can understand it will be quite messy if I draw a box at each of the arms. Okay, so I haven't done that. Okay, so I have denoted it with the resistance. So these are basically impedance. It can be replaced by a capacitor or an inductor or even a resistor. So now I want to calculate the equivalent resistance in between the opposite diagonals. Opposite diagonals. Okay, so how do I calculate? Here you can see A and F, they are my opposite diagonal. So how do? We take the help of equipotential. So what is equipotential? It is valid only for symmetrical figures. So how do we calculate the equipotential point in this diagram? So look for all the points which has equal distance from input and equal distance to that point from the output. So here you can see A to D, it is one impedance distance, okay, one Z distance. A to B, it is one impedance distance, A to B. Even A to H is one impedance distance, okay, one impedance distance. Now see to the output F. F to D, how many distance? Either you can go from F, E, D. So that is two impedance distance, F, E, D. Or you can go what? F, C, D. Still it is two distance only. Or you can go from F, C, D also. So that is also two distance only, two impedance distance. Now if you see F to B, how you can go? F to B. Either you can go from F to C to B or F, G, B. Still it is two distance only. So I am writing directly F to B. It is also two distance, two impedance distance. What about F to H? F to H, you can see either you can move from F, E, H. Either you can move from F, E, H or you can move from F, G, H. So that is also two impedance distance. So now what I told, equipotential points are those points which have equal distance from the input and equal distance from the output. So this D, H and B, they are basically equipotential points. I can replace this three point by a single point, okay, And you can see also, if I draw a straight line, it will pass through D, H and B. So this D, H and B are symmetrical. Now similarly, you check for E, C and G. If you check for E, C and G, you will be seeing what? Even E, C, G are equipotential points. I will be doing it very fast. Now look, A to E. What is the impedance distance? You can see A to E, you can move from either ADE or AHE. So two impedance distance. What about C? A to C, you can see either you can move from ABC, so two impedance distance, or you can go from ADC, so that is two impedance distance. What about your G point, A to G? Either you can go from ABG or you can go from AHG. Okay, these are the only point possible cases that you can move. So that is also your 2Z. Similarly, you can also calculate the impedance distance of this point from the output. It will be 1. Okay, so this, if I draw a straight line, you will be seeing this ECG, they form on the same line. So I can replace this ECG by a single point. Okay, so this is known as my concept of equipotential. So simple thing is what? I need to replace this D, H and B by a single point. So if I do that, let me copy this diagram to the next page. So now what I will be doing, I will be replacing this D, H and B by a single point. So this is my A point and this is in between A and D. I have one resistance, or I can say impedance. So I am replacing this D, H and B by B only. Okay, I am considering this D is equal to B is equal to H. So I can write any one of them. Okay, so I am considering B. So this is Z. In between A and D, I have Z. In between A and H, I have what? I have Z. In between A and B, I have Z. Okay, so remember this. D is equal to B is equal to H. So all of them are Z. Okay, fine. Now in between Z, okay, E is equal to C is equal to G. Okay, so I need to replace ECG by any one of the points. I can denote it by E, or I can denote it by C, or I can denote it by G. It doesn't matter. Okay, so you can see what, in between H and E, I have one Z. So E is what? It is, I am denoting it by C only. Okay, so this is C. C is what? E. So there is one impedance. So this I have taken. In between H and G, there is one impedance Z. I have considered this, I have considered this. Okay, fine. Now what am I left with? In between D and C, there is also this impedance. Okay, so D is actually equal to B and C is equal to C only. So again here I will be having one more impedance. Okay, Z. So I have taken care of this impedance and this impedance. Now I am left with is this and this. Okay, fine. So now you can see what, in between F, E, C and G, I have three more resistance in parallel. Okay, so C is equal to E is equal to G. So in between E and F, I have one impedance. In between C and F, I have one more impedance. इन बिटवीन जी एंड एफ आई हैव वन मोर इंपीडेंस, ओके जेड. सो इन टोटल आई हैव हाउ मेनी, आई हैव नाउ, सो आई हैव टेकन केयर ऑफ दिस थ्री रेजिस्टेंस ऑल्सो. ओके, नाउ आई एम लेफ्ट विथ वॉट, आई एम लेफ्ट विथ सी एंड बी. सो सी एंड बी देर इज वन रेजिस्टेंस, डी एंड ई देर इज वन रेजिस्टेंस एंड ई वन. सो आई हैव लेफ्ट आई थिंक सम प्लेस. सो वेर इज दैट रेजिस्टेंस? दिस थ्री आई हैव कंसिडर्ड इन बिटवीन ए टू. ओके, दिस थ्री आई हैव कंसिडर्ड, फाइन. नाउ इन बिटवीन ई टू डी आई हैव वन रेजिस्टर, सो दिस ऑल्सो आई हैव कंसिडर्ड. नो नो नो, आई हैवंट कंसिडर्ड दिस. देर विल बी थ्री मोर रेजिस्टेंस हियर. लुक फॉर दिस थ्री, आई विल बी हैविंग थ्री मोर रेजिस्टेंस ओवर दिस प्लेस. ओके, सो आई हैव थ्री मोर रेजिस्टेंस. सो दिस इज जेड बाई थ्री, जेड बाई सिक्स एंड जेड बाई थ्री, दे आर इन सीरीज. सो जेड बाई थ्री इज टू जेड बाई थ्री प्लस जेड बाई सिक्स. सो इफ आई टेक एलसीएम इट विल बी सिक्स. नाउ थ्री टू फोर, फोर प्लस वन होल, दिस इज जेड. सो दिस विल बी फाइव बाई सिक्स जेड. वाई थ्री मोर? बिकॉज यू कैन सी आई लेफ्ट दिस थ्री हियर. ओके, दिस वन एंड हियर ऑल्सो, दिस वन हियर इन द बैक आई हैव लेफ्ट. So you have to consider this also. So these are in parallel. So there will be six resistance. If you draw very carefully, you will be seeing. Okay. So Z equivalent. Z equivalent is what? Z equivalent is the actual impedance in between these two points. Okay. So that is equal to what? 5 by 6. Similarly, here you can see. Okay. I have written the result also. So I had written the result also previously. You can see Z equivalent is equal to 5 by 6. Similarly, if I want to calculate the Z equivalent for this case, what is that? If I connect the Z equivalent in the same side, okay, in the same side, if I connect, if I want Z equivalent, so you will be seeing this D and H. D and H, they will be forming one pair of equipotential point. And C and G, they will be forming another pair of equipotential point. You can check. Look, A to D, you have one impedance distance. A to H, you have one impedance distance. Now, how will you go from B to D? Either you can go from B, C, D, two impedance distance, or you can go from B, C, F, E, D. So, that is four impedance distance. How can you go to H? B, G, F. Okay. Or you can go from B, C, D, E, H. So that is again four impedance distance. Okay. So the same distance you are transversing from input and output to the same point. That is why D and H are equal. So similarly, you can check for this one also. C and G, you will be seeing you are getting the same impedance distance. And the Z equivalent in this case will be what? It will be 7 by 12 of the impedance in each arm. Okay. Now, what if I want to calculate the Z equivalent in the opposite diagonal in the same face? It will be Z equivalent 3 by 4. 3 by 4 of the impedance in the same branch. Okay. Now, what will be the equivalent point here? If I ask you about the equivalent points, so it will be what? This E and C will be one of the equivalent point, and H and B, this will be another equivalent point. So I will leave this as homework. If you people have any doubts in this, you can just comment in the comment section. And in the next video, I will be solving this, all the three diagrams properly, okay, with you people. If you are not able to solve properly, I will be solving all the equipotential diagram with you people. And don't worry, even in the questions, I will be solving with the concept of equipotential, okay, no need to worry. But for our exam point of view, you can just memorize this three value. Whenever it is connected to the opposite diagonal, it will be 5 by 6 into Z. Z is the impedance of each branch. when it is connected in the same face, okay, same side of the same face, it will be 7/12. When it is connected in the opposite diagonal of the same face, it will be 3/4, okay. Now there is something known as concept of supernode. So what is a supernode? If a voltage source, it doesn't matter if it is independent or dependent, if it is connected in between two reference node, then the two reference node form a supernode. Okay, supernode, it is connected in between two nodes. Okay, supernode, it has no voltage of its own, and supernode requires application of both KCL and KVL. So I will be explaining the concept of supernode with the help of an example. So you can see supernode, as I told you, it is what? It is connected in between two non-reference node. So you can see this is two non-reference node. What is reference? Reference is basically the ground, the node that has been connected to the ground. So you can see it is connected in between two reference non-reference node. This 10 volt is connected in between a reference node. Why? This is one of the node is connected to this 10 volt. Okay. So this 5 volt, this node A and this node B, it constitutes a super node. So how will we solve this? We will solve this with the help of super node. So apply node at A and B. So what it will be? VA minus 10/1 plus VA/2 plus VA minus VA, okay, so rest will be, so you completed this point, VA minus this point, this point minus this point, and now you are going to B, so plus VB/3. You will be directly applying node at both this point, okay, node KCL equation at this point A and point B. So VA minus 10, VA minus 10, VA minus 0/2. Now coming to this point, VB/3 plus VB minus VA/4. VB minus VA/4. Okay, fine. This is one of the equation. Second equation will be what? VA minus VB is equal to 5. So with the help of these two equations, you can get the value of VA, you can get the value of VB. It is very simple, okay? So when we solve question at that time, we will be discussing more about KCL, KVL and how to apply KCL, KVL, okay? So I will be explaining that also. So this is how you solve super node. In super node, you have to directly take the KCL equation of both the node. You can see I took KCL equation at node A. So if I take KCL equation at node A, stand at the node, okay, stand at the node and subtract all other points, okay. So look, VA minus 10, VA minus 0/2. So we have finished all other nodes. Next is this node. So VB minus 0/3, VB minus 10/4. So this is what I have written here. And the next is application of KVL. So this is VA is equal to what? If I apply KVL from this point, it will be what? VA is equal to 5 plus VB. So this will be what? VA minus VB is equal to 5. This was application of KCL. This is application of KVL. Okay. So this is what I have written. Super node is application of KCL, KVL plus Ohm's law. Okay. So the next is what? It is concept of super mesh. So super mesh, it is also applicable for independent and dependent sources, current sources, okay. So it forms in between two mesh, okay. Super mesh, it comes in between two mesh. Super mesh has no current of its own, and it also requires the application of both KVL and KCL, okay. So I will explain this also with the help of an example. So look, you can see what? This current source is connected in between this mesh 1 and mesh 2. So that is why it forms a super mesh. Now, how do we write the equation for this super mesh? So let me assume this current is I1 and this current is I2. Okay. So So now if I write, how will I write it? Minus 10 plus I1, and this one I will be writing as what? Plus 3 I2 plus 5 equal to 0. This will be equation number 1. And the next equation will be what? I1 plus 2 will be equal to I2. You can see this is I1. From here 2 is flowing. So this I1 plus 2 is equal to I2. So this is very simple. I have written the mesh analysis or mesh equation for this first mesh and this second mesh. Okay. So directly I have written considering the values of voltage for this super mesh. So this whole branch, it actually constitutes our super mesh. So I haven't written any KVL for this super mesh. Directly I have written the mesh analysis for this loop 1 and loop 2. Okay. So this is the example of our super mesh. Now you can solve what? For I1 and I2, as you have two unknowns and two equation, you can solve it. Okay. It is very simple. So with this, we have actually covered the first basic lesson of network theory or circuit theory. Now the next session, it will be the questions, few good questions that might be asked in HAL or HPCL. I will be taking care of all those things. So in the next session, we will have few good questions to solve. Okay, then see you in the next session. And if you have any doubts, you can write in the comment section below. And if you like my lecture, please like, share and subscribe our channel. Okay. So then see you in the next session. Thank you.